Hi, and welcome to Care. It's Makeup Monday. I've dubbed it Makeup Monday because it's the only day that I wear makeup. Our house is full today as we talk about a topic that is really, really dear to my heart, creativity in education. I think that I know we're going to have a lot of conversation today because everyone on set all have a passion for seeing the education system move forward into a little bit more of a creative realm. I'm going to introduce our guest, and then they're going to get started introducing themselves. I'm very excited. I mean, we actually have an audience today, that's to tell you how crazy things are in here. So we have Rhea. Rhea needs to pronounce her last name for me.
Yes.
And she will. Rhea is an education specialist. Rhea has a wealth of experience in dealing with research and education. You've done work in Guyana. You're definitely going to tell us about that foundation. And she's working with the ministry in a research capacity. And I find that very exciting. I actually met Rhea in the last set of training sessions that I was so privileged to attend. And I know she's going to tell us a lot about those brown bag sessions. I'm really excited about what I've seen so far in attending. We have our doctor. It's the last time we're having him on this show. He's going back to the States. Oh. If you're now following Care, Dr. Hakim Williams, son of Laventil, he's doing us proud. He has his PhD and he's an assistant professor at Gettysburg in Africana Studies and Education. He has really, really great ideas to see, you know, taking our country forward in education. We have Anthea. Anthea is the founder of the Bridge Foundation. I love everyone that's on my panel today. I really, really love everyone on my panel today. Anthea has actually just taken my book and developed lesson plans around my book. And it was like, oh, wow, I never thought that we can take a simple book. I mean, yes, I wrote the book based on what you can teach about our history of our athletes and whatnot, but she used it now in comprehension and spelling and all sorts of things, and it was like, oh wow, a whole new world just from one little storybook. And we have Roger. Roger is Mr. Energy. I think between my energy and Roger's energy, our set is gonna blow up today. Roger is the founder of Cash Flow Club, which is, we're actually the largest cash flow club, correct me, of the Robert Kiyosaki internationally.
One of the largest.
So, yes. So that is really exciting that, you know, in Trinidad and Tobago, we have one of the largest cash flow clubs in the world, so that's doing really well. And I want to hear about mad science as well, because he's known as our mad scientist to children. He teaches science in a very innovative, very creative way. So let's get started. Yes, where are we going to start? Now I have to remind you guys to keep those mics, the ones that don't have a pin.
Yes.
Right. Okay.
Okay, so my last name is Boafo.
Boafo.
Yes, it's Rhea Collingwood Boafo. It's actually Ghanaian and in origin, but I'm from Trinidad and Tobago. And so my work in the Ministry of Education, the program coordinator for the Technical Corporation, which is an IDB funded grant that we received. And the intent is really, how can we enhance the education strategy? And so the whole idea of creativity and innovation, those are some of the buzzwords that really excite myself and the team that I work with. I have an amazing team. It's a good thing that you're probably not here, because that'll be too much energy. Right? Because and I think that you need to have energy, right?
Oh, yeah.
To get involved in something like education and stuff. It really requires a lot of passion and stuff. But I want to give the guests the opportunity to talk a little bit about themselves.
I want to hear what the ministry is.
Okay, good. It's my time. Well, I'm glad. I don't want anybody to accuse me of hugging the mic. Right. Okay.
When Anthea gets started, it's
okay,
all
good.
Over.
So
all
good.
Over
I'm glad. Good. So this is my moment now. Okay.
This is your moment.
So it's interesting. I'm hearing a lot about, in terms, I love what I hear about cash flow, etc., and even your foundation. So in the Ministry of Education, our portfolio really is about how can we do three things. One, we want to get persons to be engaged with and in research, but we've expanded that notion to include evidence, because what we realize is that it's not just about systematic inquiry, but also, you know, there may be anecdotal evidence, stuff, you know, things that you hear when you're growing up, like my grandmother used to always say, you know, Rhea, the train of success is always going and it doesn't wait for anyone. You jump on and you hold on. And those are anecdotal things, right? It's not something that someone can say they actually saw a train and this train, you know, took this time. So we really want to give a space for persons who have critical information that they can share that can improve the education system as well. The other thing that we seek to do is that we really want to get a more indigenous research. We really want to prioritize indigenous research. A lot of times we consume research, and that's fine, that, you know, we can always look in other jurisdictions to see what they're doing. But there are a lot of creative things happening right here in Trinidad and Tobago. Yes. There are a lot of teachers who have indigenous best practices that they need to write books. We probably need to let them talk to you, and then you can use them.
And they will tell you that there are some phenomenal science books written by local teachers.
Yes.
And I am like, I remember when, you know, when Anthea invited all the, some local authors together, and I was like, but this book is incredible. Why are we not using it?
Okay, thank you, thank you.
Why are we not using
you.
It? I mean,
yes.
Incredible.
So we want to give a, we want to create a forum by which we can get indigenous research out there, people knowing about the best practices that we've developed in Trinidad and Tobago that teachers are using in their classrooms.
Well, hopefully by the end of the show, you're going to have tons of people reaching out to
yes.
say, hey, what? Because I know, it's out there, Anthea knows it, it's out there. And we're just ready to give you the information. So guys, find Rhea.
Yes, no, please do, please do, please do.
Yes,
yes, at the ministry, and that's the third thing that takes us, and thank you so much for that, because that's the other segue. The third thing is that we really want to build sustainable partnerships, because we realize that the Ministry of Education should not be doing it alone. I didn't say cannot do it alone, right? Because I'm still working there. But should not be doing it alone, because it does take on, I remember hearing this from, Dr. Larrier, she said, you know, she referred to it as the ecosystem, and that everyone has a role to play, and that we need to take a very integrated approach to dealing with a lot of these systemic issues. And so we know that parents have a role to play. We know that the entrepreneurs have a role to play. We know that the doctors have a role to play. Yes, you're going to the US, but we take them back just now. They have a role to play, right? Come to a brown bag session.
Yes.
So they have a role to play. Because I'll tell you something, my interest in education didn't start within Trinidad and Tobago, actually. So when you mentioned
about
good.
Guyana,
so it's actually in Ghana, right?
And Ghana.
That happens a lot, right? But probably that has nothing to do with why I have the last name Ghana, people, right? I went there to do work. Good. So, disclaimers. Right? So the thing about
I was
that,
about to ask
I got introduced to education through, at the time I was studying at Stanford University, and I just have to give them credit because they provided so much support. And they gave me funding to start a program in Ghana called an academic enrichment program. Now, initially when we started this, which was about 6 years ago, actually no, 11 years ago, when this program was started while I was in school. The interesting thing is that initially it was called a motivational camp, and it only targeted girls. So because, you know, at that time, that's what donors were talking about, girls' education, etc. But when we went into the community, it's a fishing rural-based fishing village community, we realized that actually the boys were more disadvantaged, because whenever there was time for fish, they would call the boys out of the schools, and they are the ones who were expected to earn an income, especially in the informal sector. And so even though the buzzword was about girls' education, that wasn't the need of the community, and we wanted to be responsive to the need. And we started with a motivational camp, but then I attended a session, which is why I really love research. I attended a session by Dr. Julie Wilson, where she spoke about the use of a deficit model. And she said, when you say something is a motivational camp, you suggest as if motivation is lacking, and you are now coming to provide motivation. But here you have children who are going to school in sometimes conditions that are not, I mean, we close down school sometimes because there's, well, people don't attend school sometimes because there's no air condition. We're talking about children who sometimes go to school under a hut. And this is not the whole scene for Ghana, because Ghana is a very wealthy nation. I don't want to, you know, reinforce certain stereotypes. But I'm talking about in this particular fishing-based rural community.
Right.
That was their condition. And these people are coming out, students are coming out, despite some conditions that we would normally stay home for. We don't have winter in Trinidad and Tobago, but sometimes people want to shut down for a little rain. Like this morning, you know, we want to have a storm. We tell meteorologists, I want to have a storm, boy, that looks like a cloud coming, you know, and they are going. So it means that they have motivation. Mm-hmm. What we realize is that they lacked resources because of some of the inequities. The fact that, you know, there's a distinction between urban and rural. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times, a lot of the information, a lot of the access to resources, it's normally concentrated in urban areas. And in this particular rural area, like, for example, when I ask them things like, do you know about SATs, etc.? They didn't even know about it. So it's not that they didn't have an interest in it, they just didn't know. So we changed it from motivational camp to academic enrichment. And also what it does is that there's a subliminal sort of, I don't know how to put it, but there is a sort of a condescending way when we go to people with this attitude, you know, that we are the saviors. Mm-hmm. Right? So I'm coming to give you something, and we recognize, no, this is an enrichment camp. You already have the motivation. You already have so many great things going for you. You already have some social capital. How can we enrich this or add value to it by providing resources? So we started with a one-year academic enrichment after-school camp that we have, so every child goes through that. Mm-hmm. We also provided some of the children with scholarships so that they can continue their studies. We also provide them in the summer, which we need to talk about a little bit.
Nice.
We added a component called the Youth Entrepreneurship Program. Yes, he's coming over to Ghana. And then we'll make a pit stop by Guyana. Right? Because I've not been to Guyana yet. But we have this program called, we have incentive. So there's this Youth Entrepreneurship Program, mm-hmm. which again is because we realize a lot of these children were peddlers. Because they were supporting their parents, as I told you, sometimes they would go for fishing, etc. But they're in the informal structure, and we said, you know, informal sector, and we said, you know what? If we teach you how to develop a business plan, if we teach you how to budget, if we teach you how to market, mm-hmm. even their junior high school students, and we were surprised. Initially, what we did is we give them about, what is equivalent to about 100 TT in seed money, right? And we said to them, this is just for you to prepare your business plan. We were surprised these children actually started businesses, selling eggs, selling water, which they call ensu, selling, and then they made a profit. And one time they have to then present to a local business person who
can
then has to,
there,
who then has to, do you understand?
As she says that, because you know we talk in Ghana.
Yes.
But let me find the page. John
Excellent.
Rahal,
right,
one
yeah.
of our mm-hmm. top businessmen, mm-hmm. his story is all about him needing a water heater, him and his 8 siblings all mm-hmm. poor
okay.
and fed up of cold
okay.
water, and the
okay.
father said, go to a Rema market, go into town, buy
yes.
some clocks, and bring back the clocks. And
yes.
he's like, yo, I want a water heater. Why are you giving me all this money to buy clocks? And he make him stand up at 9 years old outside the Arima market and sell clock at a profit. 9 years old.
Wow.
So it's happening right
yes.
here.
Yes.
And I tell this story, the book is coming into a year yeah. anniversary, and I tell the story all the time, and you would not believe the effect that it has on children. I mean, my daughter started her business at 5 years old
exactly.
because of John Rahal's story, because we show it.
Yes.
You can start a business, you know.
Yes.
Little boys picking limes. I see it all the time after I tell this story. They package their lime and they come to swim in and they sell it for $5.
Yep.
So
and
that's their only
and that's
time.
That's actually the most important skill in business, the ability to sell. So, you know, even though we have the best entrepreneurship program in the world, we still don't teach people how to sell. You have to learn that on your own. And the best way to learn is get a part-time or full-time sales job. You know, those with a sales background have a huge advantage in business.
Yes,
so
I always say salespeople are the ones who become
oh, yeah.
CEOs.
So the first step that people take after they do cash flow is get a sales job or get sales training, do sales courses, read sales books. They immerse themselves in the world of sales because that's actually what makes you or breaks your business. Sales equals income.
Well, you see, that's why we need to have you over there as well.
Yeah.
I
want
to add that we should be teaching folks how to sell, but also how to create
yes.
and innovate. Because we just don't want to sell what the West is selling us. We want to sell our own indigenously created things.
Agreed.
Oh,
absolutely.
I was
absolutely.
When I was using that with indigenous.
Yes.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
absolutely. And that's something, I mean, out of upmarket, I go to upmarket all the time and I sit and I go, why are you still employed? You know, all these moms there on a Saturday with the best candles, the best oils,
mm-hmm.
all created at home in their homes. And I'm thinking, yo, you want to be a full-time mom, you've got it right here. Like, we need to start to sell the jewelry. I mean, you go to upmarket.
It's beautiful.
And it's all there. It's all there. You know, I mean, we talk about having a Forex problem. It's all right there.
Yeah.
You know. And I'm so glad you mentioned a Forex problem, because what we've realized is that, you know, a lot of times people talk about being solution oriented, but you can also be problem centered as well, right? Because necessity is the mother of ingenuity.
Absolutely.
And sometimes we see a problem as something, you know, and it's so interesting. I remember they saying that the word problem in certain other cultures is actually the word challenge.
Oh yeah.
And it's also, if you turn spin it over, it becomes opportunity.
Yep.
Absolutely. And that's what we're really trying to show these children, that look, well, particularly the group that we work with in Ghana as well, even in Trinidad and Tobago, we need to start to engender a sense of innovation, but also a sense of resilience.
Yep.
And to realize that these challenges are actually opportunities. Well, and it's not to say that we ignore the inequities that are there, the systemic inequities, but you recognize that if it is, you provide certain resources that would help to, you know, to balance it off, that persons don't have a, you know, woe me, oh my gosh, I come from this background. I mean, people are making, look at what you're talking about, people
but
are making
but
it.
That's why I like, that's
and
why
that's
I
why
wrote this book. That's why I'm being told we need to
and
go on
a
break.
Oh,
but
okay,
that's why I like this book. Well, that's what Auntie was going to say.
Yeah.
Because I don't tell the success part of the stories. I tell the struggles. I talk about Keyshawn selling crab to afford to go to school. I talk about Rhea Ramnarine collecting coins off the floor.
Mm.
You talk about John Rahal that's out there. He had to sell his clocks to earn his water heater. And I mean, right? I mean, you talk about Dwayne Bravo. Dwayne Bravo started at 5 years old. The entire village came together to produce Dwayne Bravo. They all pitched in to buy his boots, to buy his bat. Kyron Pollard, I could sell my interviews. But Kyron Pollard will...
That's actually what got me into business,
yes,
being an athlete and having all these excessive costs. Because when we represent Trinidad and Tobago, we pay our own way, you know, as
we
a national athlete.
We absolutely
That's
do.
What got me into business. I had to figure out how to afford all this traveling, how to afford equipment, all the training and then
okay,
gym.
Okay, guys, we have to go on a break. This is the second time I've been told. So let's go pay some bills and we get back into creativity and education. We promise you, we're going to have a list of things for the parents as well. You know, how can you get your kids really, really interested in education? What are some things that you can do at home? How can you be creative at home when we get back? Now, you know, I think we really, really need for this particular show to have some background footage shown after. It's like crazy on the break. Guys, if you're just tuning in, we're talking today on CARE about creativity in education. We have with us Dr. Hakim Williams, who is an assistant professor of education at Gettysburg in the States. And he's going to give you just a few things that, you know, how can teachers, without changing, because, I mean, while we do have the Ministry of Education here today, the truth is, it is a process. It's going to take us some time before we change the entire education system and we really see education.
Probably 100 years.
So how do we, very economically, make some changes? You know, I'm definitely going to chime in with my seminar, but what do you see? You have a lot of experience in the classroom. What are some things that, very economically, teachers and parents can implement?
So I'm laughing till a place of storytelling, so I'm going to tell a story.
All right, we like stories.
Regarding a teacher from my research. She's a Muslim teacher. She said that when she started at the school, she was very frustrated, always yelling, screaming at the kids, wanting them to behave. She said they were out of control. And she realized, well, that wasn't working. So therefore, necessity driving ingenuity. She said they were only interested in singing all these crazy Jamaican songs with all the cussing in it. And she said that music was so anathema to who she was, her conservative values. She said one day she went home and she spent the next couple of months learning the lyrics to all those crazy songs. And she said one day she came into the classroom and while they were singing, she started busting all the lyrics and they were like, "Miss, what are you doing?" You know, but in that moment, she cracked open a door. She won their respect. And so now at the beginning of each of her classes, they spend like a little 2-3 minutes, they play the music, they dance up, they sing, and then she said, "We've done your thing, now you do my thing." And then they switched to her work, and she said their grades went up. the point where she was saying, these kids are not stupid. She said, look what they... Now, mind you, in other classes, they were not responding that way. So it indicates to me that students absolutely have agency, even when they're indicating a kind of oppositionality in the school space.
Yep.
We often think that they're stupid and we write them off. And so that's just one example of how a teacher can be really creative, but you really have to reach students where they are and win their respect. And once you do that, students recognize, you're giving me respect, I'm going to give you back some respect. And that really drives the education. And when it comes to home, I was speaking with some parents at a primary school, I won't name it, a primary school recently doing a workshop. And I was telling parents, I said, I was really perturbed when the Prime Minister called our children monsters, because what was missing from that statement was that we in society, we create those monsters. Children are not born monsters. And I said, in our homes, children watch us as the parents. We are the first teachers, and that we should be modeling. So for example, if you want your child to be focused on reading, are you reading at home? Do you have a little mini library at home? So if your child is seeing you reading at home, the child will be encouraged to read as well. Are you making education fun? When the child comes home, are you like, hi, welcome home, honey, where's your homework today? And you're diving in it together. And I'm like, if it seems like a chore and laborious to you and you're giving that energy to the child will inherit that kind of energy. And that's something really simple, I think, that parents can do.
Yes, I absolutely.
You touch on a very good point there, making education fun, because.
Oh, he have a fun.
Oh, Okay, so you know, when you make learning fun, you bring out the inner genius in people. And I mean, we do that for kids and we do that for adults as well. We've proven that works extremely well.
In fact, in one of the Brownback sessions I attended, they did speak about the statistics. The more fun anything is, the more the children learn. And that was proven. In Trinidad and Tobago, it was already proven. Mm-hmm. So we've gone past that. You know, the statistics are there to show if it's fun, they're going to learn.
You don't even have to try to get them to learn once it's fun. Yeah, so even cash flow with that dance or music playing in the background, they just totally zoned out learning. The genius is showing right there. You know, at mad science is a lot of fun, hands-on science experiments. Kids go absolutely nuts, and they learn at a very accelerated rate. So when they go back in the classroom, you know, they're still inspired to learn, and that's what they carry that on throughout the rest of the school lives. That's why mad science is number one in science enrichment worldwide.
I think you just have to take risks. I think we're at that place
where
we don't really have a choice anymore. I think the world is running away with us. Trinidad and Tobago needs to catch up big time. And we have to be honest and have an honest conversation in terms of where we are in the scope of things, in terms of the world. I think I love what you said when you talked about the creativity and the talent that is here in Trinidad. We see it every day when we're in the classroom, right front and center. Our children are doing tremendous things with a little prodding, not even with a lot. I can't imagine if we had a system that really pushed our children to really think creatively, in a creative way, to really think in a with critical thinking. Where would we be? Where would Trinidad be? Instead of us being at 84 out of 144 countries in the Global Innovation Index, I think with what we, all of us were here, and we all put our energy in the classroom, I think we could even be number one.
Oh, yeah.
I'd really have faith in Trinidad and Tobago's children. They are the adults of the future. So therefore, we definitely have to invest in them, 100%.
I think
we're going to invest in them in terms of money. Money does churn things and make things happen. But I think in the classroom, in terms of teachers, I think the most important thing is for them to say, you know what, it's okay to be wrong. One of the things that we have going on in Trinidad and Tobago is that our children are actually stuck. They're stuck because they don't want to make mistakes. Mm-hmm. And I think teachers need to be able to say it's okay to make mistakes, and that you're not going to be criticized for making mistakes. What does mistakes mean?
Something.
You talked about challenges. It could be an opportunity. Making a mistake, what does that mean? That's a life journey. So if we have our children in our classroom are able to ask many, many questions, teachers need to turn it upside down in the classroom at this point. The Read to Rise project in Guaguari, we spend a lot of time, even with you, if you can, you can too. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But we really push our children to ask a lot of questions. Ask a lot of questions about what they don't know, and ask a lot of questions in terms of what they should know. But the teacher has to have the ability. They have to have resilience too, and have the confidence to know that they can be wrong, or they don't know. So let's work on it together, and then it's a research process for all of
us. I like what you talk about, the teachers admitting that they're wrong. You know, I once posted something on Facebook in terms of parents. You know, parents tend to have this, well, I'm always right. And that is actually counterproductive. You know, teachers and parents being always right. You know, I say to Jesse all the time, I've made mistakes. I make mistakes all the time.
But it's a system that is test-oriented. You have to understand.
Right. Yeah.
Remember, it's all about if I pass or fail.
Right.
So one of the things that we have to get rid of, even within the classroom, something that is very a no-no in Trinidad and Tobago, is to get rid of that pass or fail system.
Yes.
That if I don't go to this school, I have already failed as a child. Right. I didn't get into that prestige school.
I'm going to challenge
you. I didn't get into that,
that
class.
I'm going to challenge you with that one.
Well,
here's why I'm going to challenge you with that one.
Right.
Because Jesse, for the first time in life, had to do a test last week. Right? She's a homeschooler. Yes. I homeschool.
Yes.
So she has no test. But her learning does not involve a thought of a test. So we don't necessarily need to remove the test.
No, no, not remove the test.
But we are evolved and centered around the test.
But our teaching is test-oriented, and what we're trying to explain is that learning is a journey.
Right.
Right? You know, we're talking about if we want our child to be creative, what is it to be creative? What does that really mean, being creative?
But we would actually do better in the test. The children will fare
that's
better
right.
when the test comes.
When you generate
you know, but
ideas.
But it's so centered around passing.
That's right. So well, if I look at your book and we look at If I Can, You Can Too, and you'll say, okay, well, how would this be a traditional test? A traditional test would be to test, do you know Kershon Walcott? What is his name? Where did he live? John Rahal, what did he do? How did he get there? Rhea Ramrain, what did she do? That would be a test. We don't test when we're doing the learning journey about your wonderful book. The learning journey would be something like... It's about the, what you said and the story that you shared is the value system that came out of the story. So what we would do in this particular case is that we would look at the value-centeredness of your story. What happened? How did he actually become this rich guy? Because they like the word rich. So it's okay to say the word rich. And what you would find is that he overcame. He overcame many challenges as a child, but he got a lot of support along the way. You know what I mean? He actually worked hard. There were certain values, like he never gave up. And so you set the system. You set the system in the classroom and talk to the children about what is it that you would do if you want to be a sports player? What are some of the values that you've learned from this? And then we would write them down and we'll go through a whole section on the value that is necessary to be achieved, to achieve something great for yourself. So it's not necessarily about testing, it's about the journey.
Great.
And I also believe that process is product.
Yes.
And I love your process, what you talked about.
Great.
But the process that you put in is the product that you get out. And if we can spend time focusing on the process, that journey, so that when your lovely daughter takes that test,
nothing.
It will be nothing because she's read a lot, she's done a lot, she's experimented like in your science, with your science and all that wonderful mad science that I want to hear about that you have done.
Well, the moms, you know, there's some homeschoolers that did SCA. You know, and they've never prepared for SCA. They've never heard of SCA. And one day they get up, they do the SCA, their mothers tell them, just go and do this thing.
Yeah.
They pass for their first choice, flying colors. Because, you know, it was not test-driven. Your whole entire learning process wasn't all about passing SCA, you know. And they went in there, they sat, they did the SCA, and they passed for their first choice. It was like, oh, that's what we did?
Yeah.
Another thing I like is that, you know, you mentioned that, you know, it's important for kids to challenge ideas, you know. You want them to be able to think for themselves.
Yes.
And that's very important. When you look at countries like Israel, that produces a lot more entrepreneurs than any other country, one of the reasons that happens is because in Jewish culture, they challenge every idea. So a lot of Google executives, when they go to Israel, because they have their headquarters, not headquarters, but they have outlets in Israel, because Israel is known as the extension of Silicon Valley. When they go there, they get blown away because every single employee challenges the executive's ideas.
And we look at challenging
and that's good.
Yeah, we look at that as a bad thing.
I'm glad you brought that up because actually what we are realizing at the Ministry of Education is that there is a need to shift the narrative, right? I mean, you all had so many golden nuggets there, but particularly when you spoke about like how you just said about challenging ideas, etc. One of the things that we had a session that was focused on, it was focused on the issue of gender inequity. So we have what we normally have. You came to the Brownback sessions, but what we also have are colloquiums, research colloquiums, where these are targeted specifically to policymakers, and so where we want to get them engaged in evidence that can inform their policymaking, to influence in some way. And what we learned coming out of this is this concept of plantation pedagogy. I can't remember the person who wrote it.
I want to hear about that.
Oh my gosh, that watch me, that transformed.
So I'm going to pay bills first.
Yes, pay
and
your bills.
I'm going to hold
pay
that
bills.
Thought, and yes. then we're going to go into that one, because yes. I wanted to, it's the second time that I've heard you mention it. I want to hear about yes. it. Guys, don't go anywhere. We're talking yes. about creativity yes. in education, and I can't get them to shut up. How do we become creative in education? How do we get this energy into the classroom and into our children so that learning becomes fun? Don't go anywhere. We're coming right back for more care. Our sex ed capsule, keeping the toddler body safe, because of course, you know, I mean, if they're not safe, then no matter how creative we get, no matter how much fun we make it in the classroom, if they're not safe, they're not gonna learn. So we're gonna take a little break and look at our keeping our toddler body safe capsule.
Today I went to my friends, and we were going to play doctor. They were going to test my heart. I was not comfortable. Is that allowed?
Well, let's remind ourselves about the alerts. We have the see alert, the touch alert, and the talk alert. Is our heartbeat around the area that's covered by our bathing suits?
Yeah.
So would that be part of our private parts?
Yeah.
Is anyone allowed to see, talk, or touch our private parts?
No.
So do you think that when we're playing doctor, we're allowed to do the heartbeat?
No.
So how else can we use the textbook, maybe?
Facts.
We can test our backs. Even in games, we can't see, touch, or talk about private parts. Even in games, yeah?
Okay.
And we're back. Today we're talking about creativity in education, and Rhea is about to tell us about plantation pedagogy.
But I will tell you something though. I will tell you. Yeah, it's a kind of. But I'll tell you something though. Because but I'll tell you something. The concept can easily be migrated to so many things. So I attended this recording this colloquium, and let me just quickly shout out the lovely ladies that work with me, Hannah Katwaru, Antonia Wall, and Shalini Maharaj, because they really do a lot of work in terms of getting this thing out. And we had Dr. Jerome Delisle with us, and he actually presented on this concept of plantation pedagogy, but it's by Dr. Bristol, who is she actually taught in the schools in Trinidad and Tobago, but she was stayed in Australia, and I think now she's in Jamaica. And what was interesting is this whole notion of that because of our colonial past, it has informed our education system. Because remember, the education system, we inherited it. It's not like we came in and we created it. So we inherited this education system, and we inherited, regrettably, some good. Is a good thing, but regrettably some of the negative side of it, right? So for example, this whole idea of when a children are in a classroom, do we promote cooperation? Do we promote collaboration? What do we do when it's time for tests?
Competition.
It's called copying if you're trying to cooperate.
Right? We don't want to share. Don't speak. The teacher must function as the god, the master, right? So and sometimes, you know, children know this, you know, so they will want to be the teacher's pet. Because they feel that then master will make them come, they could come into the house and the ones who's the field, right? And so these kind of things, what are we doing when are we replicating this thing? Do we always have to be in control? You know, sometimes teachers feel a little uncomfortable. Let me tell you something, teaching, I am not a teacher, right? In terms of my substantive post, but I really pay honor to teachers, because you go into a classroom with about 30 children, and some of them may be engaged, some of them may be distracted from whatever number of reasons, some of them may be coming with some issues that we aren't able to always identify when they walk through the classroom and they need that care. Teachers play multiple roles, and then you have to come now and you have to get through a curriculum. And what do? We try to maintain control, because that's what we know. Don't speak. only when I call on you, you could speak. What is that? That's very much like a plantation pedagogy. Yeah. It migrates. So I attended the session and I sat there and I started thinking, I wonder if I do plantation parenting. I have two boys, right? Cephas and Zephon, 3 years and 5 years. And when if I say things like, be quiet, why must, so my mom, Cephas' grandmother, so the five-year-old, my mom said to him, because he's just prattling away, right? Takes after his mother. So he's prattling away, and my grandmother said, oh gosh, be quiet now. And he said, I want my mouth to speak, grandma. And she just, well, back in my days, it wasn't no, oh, okay. Back in my days, what are you talking about? Mm-hmm. Slap, you're playing your rude. And then she smiled, she said, okay, he wants to speak. Let him speak, let him express himself. Why is it that he needs to be quiet? Because you need to move from the room, I guess. If it is that you want your space, because it wasn't a communal room, it was a living room. And I started realizing, how many things am I so focused on control? So even with furniture, when we were purchasing furniture, someone said, you know, you can't purchase this color furniture because you have children. And I said, you know what? My children are not renting. My children live in this home. We are part of a family. So when I make a decision about whatever we purchase, if my husband's make a decision, we have to take the children into account. They get to put on what they want to wear. We just tell them, you need to be practical. Mm-hmm. If it's raining outside, you can't go with flip-flops. But choose whichever shoes that is there that you want to wear. Those little kind of, you know, independence to give to children, because what we've learned also from research is that...
It's culture, right?
It's culture.
I mean, and I think that's what we, you know, at the end of the day, we can't ignore that.
Yeah, because people think I'm so liberal.
Place,
and I'm
right,
like, no.
You know, and it, you know, when we talk about liberalization within the classroom and that children should be able to freely think and to be creative, but to do that, again, as teachers and as an education system, and I'm so happy that you're doing the work that you're doing, is that we have to change the culture. We have to change the culture within the Ministry of Education. And we have to acculturate the teachers that are now there. But they have to acknowledge where they are and where they sit. Mm-hmm. What you have done as a parent, and yes, what we do here as parents and as uncles and as aunts or whatever, is that we recognize who we are and what our realities are and our weaknesses and our strengths. Yeah. What our teachers need to do within the system is to understand that they are in a colonial-based educational system that has been brought down from our colonists, mm-hmm, and some things have changed tremendously. We have CXC now, we changed that, mm-hmm, but there's so many other things that we need to change. But we need to change the viewpoint, yeah, of ourselves and who
but
we
I,
are
but I
and understand
say, yeah,
where
we don't, it's not that, and I want to shift the narrative a bit. Yes, we need to change culture, but you know how sometimes we say we want to change the
it.
Teacher, and I want to say and that
the teachers
no,
are
the
who
teacher,
they are.
Right, and that we need to change self. And the reason I started self is because they came into the classroom with that. Remember, they came into the classroom with that, you know, yeah, where they learn it. It's from right there. I think it's starting from parenting, right
parenting.
There.
Parenting, absolutely.
But, yeah.
I posted on Facebook yesterday, a child that is ordered around will become an adult that either orders or can only take orders.
Yes.
We do not foster.
How do you feel that?
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
We do not produce collaboration. I mean, I will always remember the same thing. You lay clothes out the child, and my parents go, well, when that child starts to rule you one day, you will see. Mm-hmm. I'm like, how is it that because we're discussing what to wear, she's going to rule me? There's
but
no mean, reason why we
but
can
we have
discuss.
To,
but
we have to.
You have to bear in mind that, I know our focus is on education. You have to bear in mind that the education system was developed to the, was designed to develop employees, to produce employees. That's what it's for. So they want people to be good old employees. They want you to take orders well. They want you to read the warning signs, because back in the agriculture age, we were all entrepreneurs. We all worked at family businesses, you know, the family farm, and they worked with their mom and their dad and everything. But when industrialization happened, they wanted to produce people with industrial discipline, right? So they took all these farm kids and they sent them to a factory-style school, which we still have. It still looks like a factory. They still wear uniforms. The bell still rings at lunchtime for lunch, you know, giving you those factory kind of characteristics, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. So you can't really change your whole system. Our education system was designed to produce employees. That's why, you know, to this day, we don't really work with the Ministry of Education, and we don't really work with schools too much, and we kind of avoid it slightly because when we develop business owners. And the characteristic of a business owner is different from the characteristics of an employee. You don't get kids in school, in a classroom, to think for themselves and that kind of thing. It's hard to change an entire system. So culture is a pattern of behavior, right? Mm-hmm. And we have found a way to break through culture. And that's why all graduates, like for example, carnival time, and most people play mass, you will never see a cash cup graduate playing mass. It's very hard. because of the effectiveness of simulations, one thing you see is they'll be at the side of the road selling, making money. You know, I've seen a lot of them caterers. One guy from Laventer was said, well, I know you're proud of Laventer. He actually invested in bottled water and he made over $22,000 profit selling water Carnival Time. He didn't even rent a space. He just walked through Port of Spain selling water. You know, and I mean, because their whole programming changed. But to do that through what we call classroom style education is almost impossible. So I like the direction you all had, and I love the discussions, but I know about education as well. I have a slight approach to what's happening.
Yes. You know, and at least the con, but at least, you know, the fact that we have the Ministry of Education being represented here today in an official capacity says that we're getting somewhere. They're open to the conversation, and I think that that's a big thing.
Yes.
I mean, I was so relieved. I mean, when I sat down and said, oh my gosh, like, this conversation's happening, I was so delighted to see that the conversation was happening at Ministry of Education.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we're going to get somewhere. It's a big step.
And they need to bring him in schools. They can bring him in schools. Because it's not impossible. Because you could give your message and it could plant a seed in some teachers and they could start changing their pedagogy.
Here's what happened.
Yeah,
so years ago, the last
That's
kid,
all right, it's years
the last,
ago.
The last 16 year kid, the last 16 year kid, he came to 2 cashier sessions, right? He got permission from the school to do a cake sale. And my boy just kept that sale going, right? So by the time the school caught up to him, he was already selling stationery, juice, cookies, making $2,000 a week. So they suspended him. You know why? He wasn't focused on his homework. Focus on his schoolwork. Don't make money in school, right? He got suspended. That was the last kid we trained. After that, we said, okay, 18 years and over. Strictly 18 years and over.
But this is where
we need
where,
to create space within the school for different types of intelligence. We have multiple intelligence, right? That is the big thing, right? Right. We do know that. We all know that. I'm speaking to the choir here. We all know that we are diverse among all of us here.
Mm-hmm.
How we learn is very different.
Mm-hmm.
It's very dynamic. It's very interactive.
Mm-hmm.
What we do every day. But in a classroom, something happens. Somehow we're able, the kids have to power off. Remember, they're powered on before getting into the classroom. When they're in the classroom, they're doing mobile apps, they're doing social apps, they're doing social media.
Mm-hmm.
So they're reading and they're writing all at the same time and they're listening all at the same time. I don't know how they do it, but they do it. I'm in between. I'm getting there, but not almost there. But when they come into a classroom, they power off. So we're doing something wrong already.
But this is why I like
so we need
story
to
about
connect
the teacher,
to the children to make sure that it's diverse.
There are some things that you have to do. I mean, in every multiple intelligence seminar that I do, and we'll talk about that in a little bit, right? Because it's a matter of understanding every child. So for me, I believe in the beginning of every term, there's a very simple test that takes less than 30 seconds. Let every child do it. So that way you know, you have 10 body smart children, 10 music smart children and whatnot. So you know how to develop. You have a toolkit and you have different tools. I teach my math through more music this term because I have a lot more musicians and whatnot. Some parents always say to me, okay, but there's some times when you just need to sit and do what you have to do. And that's fine. With your example, as you said, I've given you something, now give me something. And children are just like adults. We're in a relationship where we do compromise. And if you're compromising, then I'm going to compromise. If you're respecting me, then I'm going to respect you. If you regard me as a person, as an individual with an opinion, then I will do the same. And that's not what we're doing. We're not starting our classes like that.
But they don't have the toolkit. What is happening with our teachers? You use the word tools. The issue is if you have a hand. But you're here. No, you're creating the toolkit. And that's where, and that's why you have to collect. So that's what I'm saying. We have to collect the best practices that is happening on the ground. So that's where we have to get the information.
So here it is.
You don't have, this is not the hammer. This is all kinds of things in here. But the purpose here is that if you have a toolkit and you just have a hammer, what do you use?
Nails. Yes,
that's you use hammer and nails. So that is our issue. So what we have to do, and I'd say collect all that anecdotal information that we have, collect all that evidence base. And then we have to create a toolkit that's diverse, that deals with the multiple intelligences and deal with what you're going to talk about now, which is the cone of learning.
Oh, yeah.
And
so
how that happens.
Hold that back because we're going to pay a final set of bills.
Okay.
And then we're going to pay the cone of learning. I know we have to pay bills, guys. We're talking about creating
creativity and learning. If you're just joining us, and we're going to find out how do you get your kids, how do you get your, as a teacher, as an educator, as a parent, how do you get them really wanting to learn and having fun learning? Don't go anywhere. You're watching CARE. And we're back. It's our last 10 minutes. Oh my gosh, that hour has flew past. We're talking about creativity and learning. We're talking about the need to have differential learning. And Anthea spoke about multiple intelligences several times. On that note, I'm gonna talk about a seminar that's close to my heart. You know, the seminar was actually birthed out of the interviews that I had done with the various heroes in Trinidad and Tobago, and realizing that, you know, everyone learns differently, everyone has a different talent, and we need to embrace that not everyone's gonna be a lawyer, not everyone's gonna be a doctor. We're showing now that you can have a very successful soca career, and so if your child wants to sing soca, let them sing soca, because it's you know, we're definitely, it's all there, the evidence is all there that you can be anything and you can earn income in any way. So if you're trying to figure out, you know, what's my child's natural passion, what's the way that my child naturally learns, then I encourage you to come to our seminar. My director is going to put up the flyer very shortly. And it's all about Howard Gardner's multiple intelligence theory, you know, Howard Gardner, 1983. So it's nothing new. More than 30 years ago, he said, children learn differently. There are 8 different intelligences. There are some children that fall very nicely into word and math, but unfortunately, that's not it. There are some children that need movement. There are some children that need music. We've all heard it. Take the music off, you can't concentrate. When in truth and in fact, if a child is music smart, they need the music in the background to concentrate. If their body's smart and you are not allowing them to move, then you know what? Their brain is gonna be focused on moving, and it's actually not gonna be focused on what you are teaching. So let them move about, and then it's taken away all that distraction, and they can actually then focus. So it's Thursday at 5:30 to 7:30, Thursday 7th of July, Saturday 9th of July. You know, we do have babysitting available. Of course, you could find all this information on my website, marshareilly.com. Contact me through CARE. You know, there's so many different ways. But I do urge parents, because when you come home, a lot of parents are so frustrated during homework time, because they themselves do not have a toolkit. They've never been given a toolkit. And so in that workshop, what we do is we give the parents a diverse toolkit. We start by analyzing, how does your child learn? How do you learn? Because you are going to teach your child in the way that you learn. And if you understand that you learn differently to your child, it's not about the way that you learn, it's about the way they learn. And you need to teach, and you need to create an atmosphere in a way that they learn. So I'm going to end there, and I'm going to let Roger, because I know Roger has hit, you know, the cone of learning. And so you can walk straight up to the camera. We're fine with that. Go on, Roger. Okay. Go on. You have to model, you know. Model. All right,
so this show.
I think Roger's shy. Roger's shy. So I'm going to do it.
Is this camera?
So this is the cone. This is the cone of learning that Roger's going to talk about here.
Okay, good. So these are the most effective ways to learn, right? And as you can clearly see, the least effective way to learn is something called, let me see if I can get the proper angle here. I can't get the angle. All right. The least effective way to learn is something called reading. Reading, you only remember 10% of what you read, you know? Hearing words is you remember 20% of what you hear. That's not a very effective way to learn. That's pretty much where our educational system is based. You go to a class, you listen to lecture, you read a textbook, prepare for exams, you write the exam, pass with flying colors.
Can we get a picture of that so we can put it on our website?
Sure, you can, yeah.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, you pass exams with flying colors, and then you forget everything the day after. And that's pretty much, that's actually a very lame way to learn. Mm-hmm. We operate here.
You just call it lame.
Yeah, lame. Yeah. We simulate the real experience. So in entrepreneurship, and in science, and engineering, and in investing, we teach with simulations. So people actually remember what they do in a casual session, right? So we bring up people's inner genius. Learning is fun. And when it's hands-on and practical like that, you reach into people's real true genius. We have something called full engagement, the same thing that is experienced by kids when they play video games, and they can play for hours non-stop, right? They're fully engaged. We achieve that in education now. So, I mean, that's true genius coming out there.
I'm going to challenge you. Here's why I'm going to challenge you.
Good.
And that came out of your game-based learning brown bag breakfast.
Oh, very
because
good.
Game-based, not
yes.
every child,
math and science,
is, but
right?
not every child is like that. And that's why, even with the game-based learning, you've got to have, Anthea says it all the time, you've got to have a combination.
Yes.
Because the truth is, if you have a child who is self-smart, that game-based learning not going to work. Because they need quiet, they need to be alone. Game-based learning ain't going to work for me, you know. I'm a self-smart child. Put me in a room by myself, I want to concentrate. So you have to first understand. And that's why when you're teaching addition, you don't come teaching addition every single day the same way. We have a week, we have 2 weeks to teach addition. We must teach it in your way. We must teach it in your way, and we must teach it in your way and in your way. Monday to Friday, we teach it different ways. A complete toolkit. I like Anthea's word all the time. It must be a complete toolkit so that each different intelligence in that class can pick up when it's their time. Anthea, what's your closing comments?
My closing comment is that we just have to get rid of this analog way of teaching. This one way. You know, it's like going down that one railroad. You know, everybody's going in the same direction, and we have to feel comfortable with that two-way. That two-way road in the classroom. And teachers have to actually own it and understand it and be committed to our children learning in different ways, but they have to be able to be willing to be open and flexible. So if we want to create a child that wants to be a critical thinker, who wants to be creative, that wants to be ingenious, that we want inventors to come out of Trinidad and Tobago. What does that mean to be an inventor? Why do you have to look outside? An inventor means they're coming up with something different, something that's never existed before. To do that, what do we need? We need to create the environment to foster children's learning so that they can be creative and be innovative and to be the trailblazers of tomorrow in the world, not just in Trinidad and Tobago, but in the world. So it's one is commitment. Commitment to change and not to be scared of it. To talk about the colonial way and what we have and what has been given to us, having the willingness and to take the risk to turn it upside down.
Dr. Williams.
And to look at that.
This is your last thing you're going to say to Trinidad.
Oh my God, ever.
You have like 1 minute. 1 minute.
And simply put, I tell teachers and parents to create an environment that is fun. Because if it is fun, children will naturally learn. I mean, we have a dull, boring pedagogy. It's boring for the teachers look bored, and the students definitely look bored. But if education is exciting, the kids will learn.
Rhea, how do we get away from plantation parenting and plantation teaching?
I want to say that, you know, we need to trust ourselves a little bit more. I think that we follow a lot because we feel that we need direction and we don't always trust ourselves. And in research, it has been proven that intrinsic motivation outweighs extrinsic motivation, even with children in studying.
These big words.
And so, intrinsic, the child's internal motivation and extrinsic, a teacher telling a child to do something, but a child learning and recognizing and appreciating the value of something, that child will be more drawn to it. So children already want to learn, because they do it naturally without even being there, right?
Mm-hmm.
We just have to make sure that we don't stifle that.
Right?
How do we keep something that's already existing? So again, not the deficit model. They don't need for us to give them something, but how do we channel what is already there and nourish it and nurture it and make them love it and not stifle it because we want them to conform, but instead we want them to innovate.
Yes.
I love it. We have one more minute. Are we going to tell a joke? Guys, well, I'm going to sell my seminar. We're going to find out about your cash flow club. Tell us, how do you get in contact with you for your cash flow club? Very quickly, give me a number. Give me a website.
Number is 768-6761. That's 768-6761. That's my personal contact info. You can find us on Facebook, Cash Flow Club TNT and Cash Flow Club Eastern Caribbean. We have two big groups on Facebook. We're very,
very
active.
But you have Mad Science as well for parents.
We also have Mad Science. So it's Mad Science Eastern Caribbean on Facebook. Or EasternCaribbean.madscience.org is the website. EasternCaribbean.madscience.org. So you can get more information on what we do. And
look for it on our CARE Facebook page. We'll put all the information
Very good.
To make it very easy, just go onto our Facebook page and we're going to put all your information.
Very good. It's all simulation based and it's a lot of fun, and we actually see the kids, you know, bring out their inner genius and change
Thank
their lives.
Thank you very much, guys. You've been watching CARE. Great.